Amen. Heavenly Father, I won't be long. Y'all help me with this lesson this morning. I won't be long. You better get home to your dressing and barbecue, whatever it is you got set up today. You better get home and do that. But if you sit here and act like you don't know the Lord, I'd have to sit here with me and write Douglas. I got security here with me. Douglas is here. Any kind of trouble. Douglas and Christopher, my couple is here. Any kind of trouble, I'm going to summon Douglas down to the front. Amen. Amen. You have your Bibles, but turn with me to Romans chapter 5. Start at verse number 6, and then we'll stop at verse number 8. Romans 5, verse number 6 through 8. Say amen when you have it. And you say, oh, Heavenly Lord, if you're still looking. Out of here for two heavenly Lords. Either nobody went or everybody found it. Romans chapter 5 and verse number 6. And I want you to look at the scripture. Where's that stand that's normally here? I want you to look at the scripture. The text says, for when we were without strength. It's an interesting text because it raises a question that we normally view from one position, but I want to try to look at it from another position this morning. I'm just waiting on the presentation to come up. But here in this text, we have an amazing suggestion, I think, from the author Paul. And I don't want to get into the treatise that he's writing as much as what he says in the verses, because it's powerful, if you ever thought about this. Because he raises a question that puts us in a situation where we have to try to figure out not the mind of God, but the world we in the redemption scheme of God. He says that we were at a point that we were without strength. And then he says in due time, and so he says that we're at a point that we're without strength, and God allowed us to be in that situation until God saw that it was time to do something about the situation that you're in. We were under this covenant that did not provide Hebrews 10:3-10:4 total forgiveness. Because every year after I sinned, I had to keep making atonements for my sin. Have you ever done something to somebody? And nothing you ever did can make up for what you've done. And every chance they saw you, they reminded you how it hurt them. They went all the way back when you were in high school and talked about stuff that you did to them. And every time you saw them, they took you back to that place to where you literally had no strength to move forward. You felt helpless until you almost gave up on the relationship. He said, but then God, now watch this, he makes an illustration. He says, for scarcely would someone die for a righteous person. And I don't know how you see this, but that someone is Christ. And I want you to put you in the text. I wouldn't die for a righteous person. There are folk in here right now that's not going to die for you. In fact, in most of our relationships, we haven't died for each other. And that's why our relationships are so cumbersome and trouble and pressure. Pre-adventure, for a good man, one would dare to die. Now, Isaiah says in Isaiah 64 in verse number 6 that my best is but filthy rags before God. The text says that, but God showed or demonstrated his love or commended his love, depending on your translation. He put on display his love. Now watch this, not for a righteous person, not for a good person, not for a holy person, not for someone that loves him back, but he died for ungodly folk. I started to wonder, what type of God do we serve that would die for somebody like you and I.
Amen.
What type of God would willingly step down from atmosphere to atmosphere, from one solar place to the earth atmosphere, down this old crusted earth, and die for folk who don't even appreciate his death? What God would knowingly, willingly, the God of the universe, know that 2,000 years later that you would be born and question his existence, and still he died on Calvary's cross for your sins and my sins? What type of God, and more than what type of person, could witness someone die for them and it don't even bother them? How can you watch somebody take your nails and take the abuse and take the spit, take the humiliation, take the shame, take your lesson and humbly die on Calvary's cross, and still you look at it and say, I didn't ask you to die for me. You, that's between you and the heavens. I'm doing my thing. What type of person who knows that Jesus, how many of you believe that God died for you? How many of you believe that God died for you? How many believe that God? I'm not doing. How many believe that God? Do you understand God died for you? I'm not going to worship him. Do you understand God died for you? I'm not going to church. Do you understand he died for you? You should have been dead a long time ago.
Yeah.
But Jesus the Christ. I just leave that alone. Something going on there. Jesus the Christ, the Son of God. Obedient to his Father's will. For somebody who is ungodly, died on the cross. He is Jesus. One that is identified in 1 John 5 and verse number 20 as the Son of God, the eternal truth, the true God. He is the one who came down from heaven, knowing that he would be rejected and despised by men, and that even today there are some folk who hate God, but yet he took their nails and bled for them. God is so good in the church.
Man.
I'm glad that I serve a God who is the true God, who is the pure truth, that loved me enough that when I didn't love him, he loved me anyway.
Yeah.
And died for me. And I still say I'm going to do things my way. God loves us so much. The Bible says, Psalm 73, truly we serve a good God.
Yeah.
God is good.
Yeah.
God had no reason to die for you. He has no reason to die for you right now. But other than that, he's God. And it started messing with me as I looked at this text. So I'm thinking, what reason would God die for somebody like me? Can I personalize it right now? I'm in a righteous sense because I have a right relationship with God. Because I've been baptized into the body of Christ. Because I've been baptized into the body of Christ. I was baptized into his death. That means that I got into what he did, but don't mean I'm necessarily worthy of what he's done.
Yeah.
When you don't understand the death of Christ, you can have somebody, God, die for you, and you look at them and say, I hope you had insurance, but I'm going to do my own thing. I'm not worried about you dying for me. When you understand the death of Christ, something hits you in your spirit. If your mother died for you, you give your mother honor and glory for dying for you, but your mama didn't die for you. Can I say amen?
Amen.
Your boyfriend died for you. You forever remember your boyfriend. Somebody laid their life down so you can be here today, and then I'll be enough to give God glory. Died for me was Jesus.
Amen.
The Christ.
Amen.
Jesus.
Yeah.
The Bible says, and John saw him in John 1, verse number 29. He looked, he said, behold, the Lamb of God who taketh away the sins of the world. Jesus the Christ died for me. What do you mean he died for me? Peter declared in Matthew 16, in verse number 16, Peter declared, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Who died for me? Matthew 1, verse number 23. Jesus, Emmanuel, God for us. What does Jesus want from me? God don't want you to do anything but to die for him. Not a physical death, but to set your life aside and to live for him. He don't want you to die, but he wants you to live. He wants you to live a life that says, I'm thankful that you died for me. I wouldn't be doing this, but I'm so happy that God died for me that I got to give God praise and glory by the way I live my life. I'm glad this morning. I can't be happy. I can't be quiet. Because God's been too good for me. Sends only begotten Son down from glory to this old wretched world to die for a sinner just like me and just like you. I look at your neighbor and say, he died for me. Y'all see it right now. Somebody said he died for me. He bled for me. Somebody said he bled for me. He agonized for me. He hurt me. And some folks sit around and say, hey, that is Jesus' problem. That is Jesus' problem. Because I'm still going to do exactly what I want to do. Y'all all right?
Amen.
All right, so I'm trying to answer this question. And then I'm further perplexed by the fact that not only Jesus died for me, but he planned to die for me. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, before the foundation of the world, there was this plan for the redemption of men. Jesus didn't just die for you, but he left heaven understanding that he planned to die for you. Y'all, I just feel the Holy Ghost this morning. Y'all know what I'm saying? He didn't just die for me, but he planned to die for me. Now, can I show how powerful this is? If I decided to die for church, he got to head up and kill me. Because I head up, think about it. If I get 15 minutes of death, oh, yeah, I could ask you right now, Jimmy, if the house was burning and you had to save Susan, would you save her? He would tell me very quickly, yes, I would go in there and save her. But what's the fire start? And what's the stuff, the wood start popping? And Susan said, Jimmy, save. Jimmy started thinking about it. He's gonna tell her, I told you to come on, woman. I'll get you. He planned. He didn't just die. He planned to die for me before I was born. Y'all start feeling good right now. I'm trying to help you. You know what I'm saying? We serve a good God. You need to tell me that God looked at my life and saw I was no good, saw I wasn't gonna do right, so I was going to get hooked on some stuff. So I was going to get to messing with folk. So I'm going to get into this thing and that thing. And his response to that was the plan to die for me in order to redeem me from the devil.
Amen.
See, that's why I can't sit in the chair and just don't say nothing because before I was, he was. And it wasn't by no accident he decided I'd go to the cross. As the Pre-Millennials say, he planned to die for me. How do you know that? Well, can you work your Bible very quickly? You have your Bible, Luke 9, verse number 22. Listen to the plan. He said, the Son of Man shall suffer many things and be rejected. Hold on a minute. You mean tell me that God knew before he came here that he was going to suffer and be rejected of man, and that he was going to go before the elders and the chief priests and the scribes, the social media of that day? He knew all of that, but he said, I must be killed. I must be slain for my people. He didn't just come to help, come to earth, manifest himself as man, John 1:14. He came down here knowing that the same people that he's going to try to save are the people that are going to murder him on a cruel, cold, rugged cross. And yet he came and that said, among the word, and you might live, and I'm the word of God who served. He said, I must. He said, 3 months, I must go down. Not that I want to go down. He said, I must. He didn't say, if I don't have to. He said, I must. It's a necessity for me to go down. Stay in Luke chapter 9, by verse number 44, he says again, let these sins, now hold on a minute, let these sins, because you got to understand the gravity of this, let these sins sink deep down in your heart. I know folk going to hate me. I know folk not going to worship me. I know folk going to build 700 churches. I know folk going to get attitudes and formulate their own opinion. I know all of that stuff. He said, but I got, let this sink deep down in your heart. I still got to go down and die for my children. Why do I got to die? Amen. Watch this. Now, here's the thing. And we're starting to make our points here. Is that not only did he die for me, he planned to die for me. And in his plan to die for me, he says then in Matthew 26, verse 54, but how then shall the scriptures be fulfilled? This must be. As if the angels might have been talking to him, saying, do we have to do it this way? As if God the Father knew that he had no other choice but to do it this way. It must be that the scriptures are fulfilled. What are the scriptures that must be fulfilled? I want you to know that God loves you and he's bigger than your sins. I want you to know that God, as I said earlier, is asking you not to die for him, but to live for him and through him. I want you to know that you were once locked up, but now you're free. Why would the God of the universe die for dope dealers, because it said they were ungodly? Die for fornicators. Die for people that don't, the antichrist. Die day. And you want to know why did you wake me up at 7 o'clock to go to church? Y'all say amen. But here's the problem. God is so wonderful that he's bigger than our sin. When I started to understand this text, I started to understand 2 Timothy 2:12, 1 Timothy 2:12, when he says, for if we reign with him, he shall reign with us. But if we fall, if we faint, if we're unfaithful, yet he remains faithful. Why is God faithful when I'm unfaithful? God is faithful because when I'm unfaithful, God died for me in spite of me. While I was in sin, while I was doing what I was doing, he died for me because I'm made in God's own image. And God's not going to allow
sin.
which is to condemn and to destroy God's work, man, is active through you until you come into a realization that it's that person that Christ, the Son of God, died for in the first place. Now, I don't know how you look at him, but if the blood of Jesus is on him, you don't look at him like you used to look at him. It becomes a stumbling block to the Jews and the Greeks. That you mean to tell me that God died for somebody like him, like him, like him? You mean to tell me, and that raises your stock value. Y'all ought to say amen. Before then, there was condemnation and sin. But Romans chapter 8 verse 1 says, now there is no condemnation for those that don't just walk in sin, but who have sin, because they now have turned to Christ. Well, he said, I'm not saying you can just sin and sin and sin and sin, Romans chapter 5, the last verse, but I'm saying that once you turn to Christ, it does not matter what you've done, it matters what you're doing in Jesus. And can y'all say amen? And when I'm with Jesus, I'm not going to hold my hand down, I'm going to raise my head up, because while I'm walking because Jesus helped me walk. Somebody say, Jesus lifted me up. Men would have never done what Jesus done. When you down, men going to keep you down. When your spirit down, they going to run you down, talk about you, lie on you, spread your lie, trash it all over town. But when Jesus get a hold to you, he's going to justify you. Y'all ought to say amen. Amen. And so what's messing folk up about you is the same people you should drink with. Now you walk around talking about God, and they don't understand it. They don't understand it. And you know, it starts to pull them toward God. Why are you pulling toward God? Because if God did it for you, I stop by to tell you right now, this very day, if you trust God, God is going to do it for you. God is going to redeem you from the law of sin. What you mean? All I've ever done was this type of life. If you turn from your sins right now in the name of Jesus, the Bible said, Luke 13:3, now I tell you, except you repent, you will perish. But if you confess him, Matthew 10, verse 32, as your Lord, you put him on in baptism, 1 Peter 3:19 through 21, and you buried him into his baptism, the Bible says, in the likeness, Romans chapter 6, verse 5, in the likeness of his death, you'll be raised up in the resurrection. And when God raised you up, he sets you up. And when he sets you up, there's some stuff that you don't mess with you. Not don't mess with you no more. You can talk about me if you will. I'm still a child of the Most High God. You can laugh about the past, but wait till God makes you frown in my future. Y'all gotta say amen. You can sit down and talk about what I used to be, but you ought to look at me now. I'm a hypocrite now. Look at me now. I'm getting paper. For myself. He died for me because folk made me feel like I was ungodly, unuseful. He died for me because I am his creation. He died for me to reconcile me back with the Father. He died for me that I might have a right to the tree of life. He died for me, John chapter 14, that I may go where he is. He died for me that I may have hope when I didn't have hope. He died. He died for me, and I'm so glad. I'm so glad. And I said, the God that died for me, all I want to do is live for him. Amen. God bless you. So I got ready to go home. Everybody got ready to go home. I'm looking for two people who's not a member of the body of Christ, and some of you are, that understand what it meant when God died for you. Don't you know when God died for you, whatever you did, you now have justification. Romans 3, verse number 25. The Bible says, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption, that is redemption, that is in Christ, we now have justification. What do you mean justification? Yes, you may have done all that stuff and may not have. You may have made some mistakes along the way, but because of who you belong to, you're not justified. It means that God saved you. You somebody that God saved. Y'all ought to say amen. If you've been baptized and you raise your hand, don't let the devil stop. Raise your hand. You look at your justify me, because nothing else could justify me. Right. What set me apart? Because if other folk died, it wasn't good enough. A good man wasn't good enough. A righteous man couldn't dare get the job done. But the raw blood of Jesus Christ sanctified me. Everybody that's in the blood of Jesus has been set apart. Y'all ought to say amen. If you haven't been baptized, you haven't been set apart. What you mean set apart? It means despite what them folks say, they don't know you like Jesus knows you. He set you apart for his good people. Y'all ought to say amen. And that's what the Corinthians says, that in him, love him, are you in Christ? In Christ means that you put him on in baptism, who God made unto us wisdom, he made unto us righteousness, he made unto us sanctification, he made unto us redemption. Why did he die for me? To justify me. Why did he die for me? To sanctify me. Why did he die for me? To save me. And I'm so glad that I'm saying that if you haven't been baptized, you're not justified, you're not saved. Why am I not justified? Because you're still living unjust. You're not sanctified. Why? Because you still have come out of darkness into the marvelous light. It's waiting on you right now. You're not saved. Why? Because you still have God in the body of Christ. Is there somebody say, you didn't die for nothing, Lord? You didn't die for nothing, because I see